Okay, you can see underneath, new Global West lower trailing arms with spherical bearings. Refurbished differential, it's got 373 gears and positive traction in there now. This gas tank has been removed and installed about 50,000 times, but it's in. All of the plumbing goes to a 58 PSI combination pressure regulator and filter. I put in and fabricated this little plate to keep those lines out of the way of the movement of the suspension. New RideTech Panhard bar, new RideTech upper control arm. The axles inside here are new. They're hardened. New bearings and wheel studs. And of course, those are the CPP brakes that have been on there for a long time. So let's get into the video. So I CNC these out, get my bandsaw set up just right so that I could run these cleanly on the fence. I split them. So there's these three lines, one's the vent, return and send, and then there's a wire loom. And the wire loom is gonna have multiple parts to it. It's gonna have the ground and lead to the pump, and then it's gonna have the ground and lead to the fuel gauge. Or sending unit, it's an electric fuel pump relay kit. This is amazing. This whole thing is amazing. But I'm a little overwhelmed. I gotta go up and over the frame. So where the frame kicks up here for the spring perches, there's a bit of a gap between the frame and the body here. So I'm gonna run it over here. So it'd be like off this bracket, and then that'll run the wire, the hoses down and under the body, and then over to the frame over there, and then I will have all the rest of the clamps drilled and screwed and tapped directly into the frame. So that way the fuel lines can come up, but they are gonna immediately go here. And then over to the frame. So, I don't know. Let's see how that works. Lines run up and over the frame. You see they go over the top of that shock tower. They go up and over, come under through that first clamp, which is now secure. This bothers me a bit. But then you can see here, it goes into the next bracket, which is now in the frame. This is secured with a thread lock nut on this back end. But that I'm gonna have to do Loctite. It's not Loctite right now. They'll go along the inside of the frame here to that next one. This is temporary. Here, it runs along here. This is okay, I think. On this part. And it keeps it real clean here. But then what? If I choose to go under this part of the frame and up, I'm gonna have exhaust right here. I got starter there, the exhaust is here. So this will be like, there'll be exhaust right there. So the other way to go is to run all these up here, but there's supposed to be a fender liner here. So if there's a fender liner here, where do I go? Do I like just penetrate through the fender? Do I try to tuck it through here? What I just don't like is that somewhere when the exhaust does come out, it's gonna be along the inside of the frame, running along here, right where these lines are. In particular in here. So the better way to do it would be to have all of these connections come off and then go to a very close nearby termination block where I could disconnect the tank back here and be able to drop it without running, you know, without having to disconnect all the lines from the front all the way to the back. So that's, I was gonna mount this bracket next to the fuel tank and use these bulkhead connectors to have terminations, disconnects that go direct to the gas tank. And then these would run, this would be the send, right? And then I'd have to have the return come back. So I've been going a little nuts with Summit. So I bought a bunch of Nycop line because you can use this for both fuel and brake lines. And I guess I didn't really think about using hard line for the fuel line. I don't know why. Because I knew you could do that, but I guess I was just assuming AN fittings, it'd be difficult to connect them to hard line, but it's actually not. There, you can get compression style fittings that fit right over the top of this stuff. So like, this is just so bulky. And I didn't really realize how bulky it was going to be till I actually put it up there. And I was like, geez, that takes up a lot of room and it's gonna be hard to fit my exhaust there. And I knew it'd be tight, but I didn't think it'd be that tight right there. And you can see, you know, that's where brake lines and fuel lines ran before, or right along the top of the frame beneath. Right now my head is up where the fuel tank normally would be. And this bar is in front of the fuel tank. This kind of stabilizes the fuel tank. So I can mount that fuel pressure regulator slash filter right here. And I can just make all my lines from the tank short and they connect right here. And then I'll fish that. You know, have the vent like here or something. Wonder if I could do that. This is the vent. So you can see it's like a bulkhead fitting. It's got like a, there's a little ball in there. I don't know if you can see it, if you can hear it, that if you have pressure, it would like push the ball up, I guess up against it. So this washer, basically if I drilled a hole up there by the filler neck, this could go through the bulkhead there of the sheet metal around the filler neck. Maybe this is on the back side. Put this O-ring on the front side. And then cinch it down. It's not entirely in the wheel well. I mean, if I ran it along here and I actually like just zip tied it too. I had to remove that back plate. So this is the old member. This is the new member. It seems fairly exact. The holes appear to line up. So start with using the same shims. We'll clean these bolts up and restore them. Probably paint that bracket. Okay, got it up there. So I tested this. This is an 11/16 nut. And I can't get to that guy. Just these two bolts and I'll be able to. Did that do it? All right. So that's off. Make sure you disconnect your brake line. And then I just gotta do that one. All right. These are CPP. New control arms. Doesn't seem to be any differentiation right or left. The spring pocket is roughly in the same place. There's no place to mount the brake line unless I use this little tab. It aligns reasonably well. A little off. I'm gonna have to hammer it or raise and lower this with the pump jack here, but should work. So to get the axle lined up on this trailing arm, since those two are already bolted up, I disconnected the sway bar and the shock. You have to disconnect the shock to get the trailing arm unbolted and then rebolted. And I used a pipe clamp to push it in and hold the axle steady while I lined it up. So I've got in on this side. I'm gonna have to finagle a bit here to get it all the way through because it's not a perfect alignment on this side for some reason. So the good news is I'm here, so I can just, I might take another clamp, maybe C-clamp, and just try to push this side up a little, get the hole lined up, and then she'll be through. Well, this was a pain in the butt, but I finally, to get this was the last piece to get in on the suspension. I basically had to loosen everything, including the upper bar, took the Panhard bar off, that other control arm over there is loosened up. I had to really like push it to get in there. So now I'm gonna try to hammer this guy up. And then everything will just be in loose and then I can start tightening everything back up again. Okay, so the way I work is to do everything like two or three times. So this, instead of a single fuel filter with the main feed going in and then out and going all the way up to the front, I would have had to run the return all the way up, like on this cross member here. These are generic three-way pigtails. You get the male and the female. They're already pinned in, and they got a little bit of lead on them, and they're weather resistant. So that seemed appropriate. I made myself a wiring loom here. This is much cleaner than before. This is the fuel relay from Tanks. I got everything pre-labeled because it's going to take me a bit to get back to this and I'll probably forget things, but this is the tank ground. This is the fuel gauge wire lead. And at the end of this pigtail, this comes from the relay. So one of these goes to battery positive, one of these goes to the ignition switch. And of course, ground. Okay, so I made this bracket. This will mount about 3/4 of the way towards the driver's side of the car. So the gas tank goes up in here. That bracket will be there. We'll feed over to that bracket. Something kind of like that. Okay, so he approves. Hey, buddy. Hey. 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 I didn't really understand this until, you know, I'm taking everything apart five times. But you have this panhard rod that comes down this way. It connects up to the frame, which is a rigid fixed position, and it connects down here on the axle. So as the axle rotates, like you ride along and it's doing these things, the whole axle's moving in this kind of arc motion. You know, if it was not constrained by the panhard rod, then it would just be moving like this. But even then, as it goes down, you're basically introducing more torsional stress in the trailing arms because they're stuck out at an angle. So as it like moves down, it's trying to move down with it, but you're like putting load on the bushing. So we fixed that with the Global West trailing arms, which I bought, by the way. I don't think I've said on the video yet, but I bought them. I'm replacing the CPPs with the Global West because they've got a spherical bearing up there on the top. So as it rotates down, it can pivot to match the arc and not put all that torsional load on the bushings. Same thing with the RideTech stabilizer, with the RideTech panhard bar. That's got a spherical bearing in it. So as it rotates through, at least it's able to sort of adjust to any torsional load. So I think, you know, by having spherical bearings in the two lower control arms and the panhard bar, plus RideTech's upper bar has a conventional bushing up here, but down here it's a spherical bearing as well. So basically I've replaced 1, 2, 3, 4 bushings, conventional bushings, with spherical bushings, which should make all the geometry of this suspension that much better. And there she is, folks. This stud was, this is the stud that goes on the axle for the panhard bar. And this long end sticks out towards the rear of the vehicle away from the axle. This short stubby end goes inside a bracket and it's kind of like shrouded, and therefore access to it is quite difficult. So you can't get a breaker bar in there to try to break the nut loose. You got to hit this, but to hit this, this thing's so long, you need a deep socket. And I think it's 1 3/8. Yeah. Seems to be the size of this nut. And I only had a short 1 3/8. And so I went over to the local auto zone and tried to figure out what I could find there. Because from the, since this is the end that you can really access with an impact, obviously I can't get my 1 3/8 socket over it. So I'm looking around at AutoZone and they had a bunch of metric ones, and I'm looking at that, and so I did a calculation, you know, what's 1 3/8 inches in millimeters, and it's like 34.9. So I found this 35 millimeter, which actually worked quite well. Okay, same issue on the new stud. This nut here is 1 1/8 inches. So the only way to get back in here and tighten it is there's just not enough clearance to really get a socket wrench back there, but I have these ratcheting wrenches, so I will use that to tighten it. I'll have to just do it by hand to get it started. Okay, it's a bit of the struggle bus. My bracket's made. And I'll either use this hole, I might rib nut it. Kind of a wonky mess right now. I'll get it through here. Up through this area. Closer tucked up into the frame and then over. Once I get sort of in a final position here, run it right up against the floor. 7/8. Who knows when the last time it was drained. Smells like burned urine. That I have to remove all four of these bolts. There's four around this flange. Basically, I can take the caliper off and hang it. Once I take the spacer off, the rotor should come off. So these bearings I replaced them when I first got this car. So they're about 10 years old with basically no miles on them. Now for the other side. I'm just gonna leave these like this. I could pull them all the way out, but it's out of the differential now. So I should be able to just pull the differential out once I get the other axle out. So this is a ring and pinion. It's from Richmond Gear. Looks like the part number is GM82373E. A ring and pinion that goes to a 373 rear gear. Pause the video if you want to read this. YDGGM55P-17-1, 55PGM17SBL, 3.73 and down Duragrip positive traction composite clutch, 26056. This is from Yukon Gear. So if you wanted to just order this direct, supposedly this will fit in your rear axle. I haven't installed it yet, so you'll see if it didn't work. Okay, when I pop this one out, it started spilling oil. So I've had some oil sloshing around in there as I've been moving the axle and stuff. Axle was just hung up on it a little bit. Just had to move it a little bit to the side and it came out. Look how clean that is in there. Boom! I started disassembling this. There's these little hold down pins that keep these from rotating. So those came off. Those are half inch bolts. And then I started taking off this portion of this cap, and then realized that I better mark it to make sure I remember which one's where. This definitely had some like somebody hit it with a chisel to have some alignment marks on it. And I think they're only on one side, so I think I'll be able to tell from there, but I just did this anyway just to remember. These are 3/4 inch bolts, and take those off, and from what I understand, I'll be able to unscrew these and this whole differential should come out. Yoke has smooth bore holes for 5/16 bolts. So I just have these finger tied in here with some nuts on the end of them. And right over the center of my pinion. And all I'm going to try to do is just push the pinion out. Right here that this tapered roller bearing was fitting in, so that'll need to come out. And what I understand is I can use a brass punch to do that. Brass because you got all this cast iron around you and brass is softer, so you can use the brass to ding that thing out and you won't scratch it up. So back to over here, waiting on some parts. So these CPP control arms, I just gave up on trying to make them fit. I'm waiting on Global West. I ordered them direct from Global West and they were producing new ones and I basically had to wait for them to finish fabrication. So I went and looked on Summit's website and you could get them from Summit in like 3 days. So I called Global West, canceled my order and reordered them from Summit. So I'm waiting for those. Obviously axles are out right now to take care of the differential. I still have to install all that and get that done. I'd like to take a little bit of time to clean this axle up a little bit more, maybe paint it and just clean it a bit, put some undercoating on it. Then once the differential's back in and those control arms are back, I'll put this panhard bar back on, get the shocks remounted. And I think that would complete everything that I'm doing with the axle and the suspension. And then I'll put the gas tank in because I wanted to wait get all this, have some freedom to move around back here without the gas tank in the way. So then I'll put the gas tank up. Gas tank's ready to go. I'll check all the fittings one last time, but it should be good to go. Then I can mount it up there on the filter regulator. I've got the line run. I'll have to clean up that wire. So I've been watching these videos. I'll try to put a link to them here or in the description. They're from Weber Auto. I think the channel is called Weber Auto, and it's a Weber Auto University. And there's a gentleman on there that is very patient and thorough, and he's rebuilding exactly one of these. And it's a four-part series, and it's excellent. It's super detailed, and he goes through and demonstrates all of the precautionary measures you need to take to make sure that you have the appropriate amount of preload on the differential and the pinion gear, and how much you really have to kind of pre-assemble, test, disassemble, then reassemble and tweak it just to get everything right. It's not undoable, like I could do it, right? But it doesn't, I think what's important is that, you know, you have to be very careful with these and not ding up these threads when you put these caps back on. You need at least a spanner tool to tighten these up. You need an inch pound measuring torque wrench with a max indicator on it, so that as you like rotate it, you can see how much load is on it. But here, where it gets real tricky is on this crush sleeve. And he cautions a lot on that video that, you know, just zipping the nut on there with the impact wrench is not the right way to do it. And he needed a torque multiplier plus like a 3-inch breaker bar to torque that thing down. And he was constantly measuring preload. And then he painted all the teeth on the gear and looked for backlash and the imprint and the way that the gears meshed. And it's just a lot of detail. So all this, the reason why I'm saying all this is, I think I'm just going to take this to a differential shop and have them do it, because they do these things all the time. These are the differences between RideTech, Global West, Classic Performance, and the OEM control arms for 58 through 64 Chevrolet full-size vehicles. This RideTech unit is meant for air suspension, so it's different than the others because the perch is just meant for the mounting screw for the airbag. Interestingly, I don't know if you could do the same on the CPP. There's about the width of my fingers clearance under there, and the same as here. The main differences are the RideTech uses these rubber bushings just like the rest of them do, except they have these grease fittings here, so you can lubricate these. CPP also uses rubber bushings, but they have no grease fittings. The CPP arm is basically just a straight tube. You can see the OEM unit has a bit of a bend to it. And this is just, you know, folded over steel, and the bearings are pressed in. These bearings have quite a bit of give on them. And so when you have the torsional flex on the frame, as the axle moves up and down, you have this sort of off-center axis of rotation. And so it introduces a torsional twist at the frame. And the OEM control arms accommodate that by being a little bit, they don't really flex, but they have the ability to flex. They can sort of pinch a little bit, and these bushings are also quite soft. The spring perch, you can see, has a place for the bottom coil to sit and rest. That is also indexed in the Classic Performance unit. Now, the big difference from Global West is that here at the frame mounting end, they have a spherical bearing instead of a bushing, and that
accommodates that torsional flex that I just talked about. They also have a screw point for mounting your brake line. The rest of them do not have that, with the exception of the OEM unit. You could probably use this hole here on the CPP unit, put in your own screw and lock nut, and you could secure your brake line there. It's kind of close to the spring, but as long as it's secure, that's good. There's also a rotating rubber insert here, a loose rubber insert for the spring perch in the Global West unit. The rear bushing on the Global West unit is also very large. I mean, it's probably almost a 2-inch bushing compared to 1.5 inches on the others. The bushings on the RideTech are generally larger as well, I think, compared to the CPP. So those are the main differences. Ultimately, I'm going to end up using the Global West. I have mounted these CPPs. They've never been run in the car, but they were installed. But I just couldn't get them to the final installation where I would put in two bolts on one side, and I would get one bolt in on the next side, and I would just have to struggle so much with the very last bolt, regardless of where it was. And it's because of that asymmetry in the axle and the torsional twist that you're trying to do. I just didn't want to ruin the bushing while I'm trying to install these. So I said, okay, I'm going to try the spherical bearing and see if that works. This is in here, but you can see it's just misaligned on this side. I've got the bolt halfway through here. But this is what I was having problems with before. I really thought that spherical bearing would make up for it. Since this bushing is monstrous, maybe I can smush it a little, but I'm really gonna have to jiggle this axle around. Okay, so at the moment, I actually have two control arms in, and the shocks are on it, but I have two different control arms in. I've got a Classic Performance over here and a Global West over there. I finally did get it to align. It's just been real finicky, but what seemed to work was once I got it in on this side, I lifted the axle and took the load off here. And once I got the load off there, I could actually stick a screwdriver or even my finger in there and get the spherical bearing to align with the holes, and then just slip the bolt through. So these bolts that secure the axle side of the lower control arms also serve as the mounting point for the shock. And after taking them out and removing them and putting them back in about a dozen times, they're pretty trashed. So I ordered some new ones. They have a very fine thread, and that'll stir up pretty easy because it's getting jammed through here and it scratches up the threads, and then they cross thread when you put a nut on it, especially when you use an impact wrench. So ask me how I know. I've got this guy mostly lined up. You can see this is the natural path of the brake line. And if I can get this guy in here with a bolt, we are good. So here's something interesting. This
Yeah, so Global West, you know, they've got some videos on this, these control arms, and they talk about the necessity for the ring gear. I'm sorry, the necessity for the spherical bearing. And they say, you know, it puts a lot of stress on your frame at the mounting point. And I thought, well, you know, is it really that severe? I mean, you can feel it. You know, just the fact that I've been struggling with these getting mounted has shown me that. But this bracket that's on here, this is it. This bears the entire weight of the car plus cornering load. And it's welded to the frame here. There's a bracket on the frame. You can see it there. And that's it. And so as I was trying to get this end of the second control arm, now they're both in, as I was trying to get that in, it was pretty tight and it wouldn't fit the two spaces that are in that spherical bearing. So I took a crowbar and I put it in here and I just tweaked it just a little to widen it up, and it widened up. So that does show me that, like, there actually is quite a bit of stress and this isn't that strong. So I'm glad that I use these, because this spherical bearing will take that torsional load off. And instead, just, you know, the only load we have to worry about is vertical now. We don't, most of the torsional load should be mitigated. Well, what started as a gas tank install and replumbing or new wiring is now a limited slip differential installation with all new rear lower control arms, upper control arm, and panhard bar. On the next video, we'll be getting into what's going on with the engine. The supercharger system is finally finished and mounted. The pulley system is there, so that'll be on the next video. But thanks again for watching. If you stayed all the way through this last video, it's a long one. I usually try to keep them shorter than this. If you like it that way, just let me know. Comment down below. Again, appreciate you watching. Please like and subscribe if you want to see more content like this. This is David Hill with Solve Fix Build. Thanks again.